Our topic is on protecting your vision, protecting your vision. And I believe that God wants us to look at some very critical points as to how a vision should be protected. Every time we look at a vision, we must always see the possibility of a global impact. Every time we talk about vision, we must always see the possibility or the chances of a global impact. Somebody say global impact. I want you to understand what God lays on your heart. Like I was saying last week, and I used the case of Dr. Martin Luther King, may just begin as a dream. And all you might think you are doing then is talking to or doing certain things that may just affect your life and the people around you. But like Dr. Martin Luther King declared his dream severally, and we looked at his life a bit last week, and he shared his dream about how he decided to see equality in the United States. It became something that later on cascaded to everywhere else in the world. South Africa and everywhere in Europe began to take racial equality as paramount and as key. And I know the world is still trying to grapple with the reality of that fact, because there are still elements of racism all over the place. It's not quite solved, but that movement led to a big, you know, change in the order of things. And so we must understand that there is a potential for a global impact. What we are doing here today, we might just see ourselves in a building in Warsaw, but you see, generations to come, Jesus tarrying to come, will be taking this message and this assignment to various parts of the world, places that we will never be able to reach. Can I hear an amen? Amen? Already we are doing that by the grace of God through the power of the internet. We get feedback from different parts of the world, and we are grateful to God for that. But by the special grace of God, a time will come when there will be buildings, where there will be people gathered in buildings across the land by reason of these humble beginnings, which look like just a group of people who God brought together in a little town called Warsaw in the West Midlands of the United Kingdom. Hallelujah. Because I've seen many global movements in ministry start in very little towns, little places. There is a church that my wife went to in the 80s, and it was just a few people in one little city called Kaduna in northern Nigeria, and they used to sit on benches, and they used to just meet with a few people, one person to a bench, and the man will be shouting, "The day is coming when we're going to be ministering across the nations of the earth, and we'll be on satellite." Many of the people he was speaking to at that time had no clue what a satellite was. We'll be speaking on satellite, and we'll be all over the world, and this message will be preached. And he was declaring the vision constantly. And this was just about 35 years ago. Under 35 years ago, in fact, about 30 years ago. And the truth of the matter is that virtually everything that was being prophesied at that time is being a reality today. Virtually every nation of the earth has the presence of that ministry today. And anytime they gather in thousands. They are so powerful now, they no longer do mortgages. When they see a building, they want to do a church plant, they say, "We like this building," and they buy it. Even if it's 10 million pounds, they just buy it. God is faithful. I say, God is faithful. And so we need to understand a vision has to be protected. Whether it's your personal vision, whether it's a vision of a church, whatever it is, it has to be protected. And so the theme of this week is very important. And the essence of this session is to show us why we need to protect vision and how we need to protect vision. And the things that always fight against your vision in life, so that you can know how you protect yourself against those things. And may God continue to help us. In the mighty name of Jesus. Is somebody excited this morning? Is somebody set for what God wants to do? I know that God is set to take your life to the next level, and he'll be doing so in Jesus' name. And so every vision given by God is a journey of responsibility. Tell your neighbor for me, your vision is a journey of responsibility. Okay? We don't like the word responsibility in our day and age because it means you've got to do something. We are in a generation where everybody wants somebody else to do something. Everybody always wants somebody else to do something. So when you go to the cash machine, I mean, this is just coming to me at random. You go to the cash machine and you put in your card. You want somebody to have made sure that it is working and somebody has put money there. And you get very upset when the machine says out of use or no money inside or whatever it displays. And you don't immediately think, you immediately remember that somebody has not done something. Because we always like everything done for us. But we must understand that if you want to be somebody who would generate anything or achieve anything in life, you must be ready to take responsibility. Every vision given by God is a journey of responsibility. A vision has measurable impact. It's not just a sense of grandeur. It's not just a dream that, you know, you just lie down one day and you saw yourself, you know, flying on a private jet and doing big business all over the world or running a huge ministry or something like that. Now, it could be like that, but it is something that not only does it stay in the realm of a dream, but it also starts to generate measurable impact. You start to see it deliver phase by phase. Praise the Lord. When God first spoke to me about ministry, I was still in my home country in Nigeria. It was in the year 1998, December precisely. I was on a flight, as some of you here, or most of you here would have heard for many times now. And it didn't look like, I wasn't expecting something like that. I was just flying to London through Amsterdam from Tel Aviv to go and just do a session with a church that invited me to minister at that time and to return to my home country in Nigeria. I wasn't expecting anything like that. And then on that flight, God woke me up in the middle of the night when I missed my meal. I've told you that many times. And he said to me, I'm taking you out of your home country to minister my word in a unique way. And I never heard anything more. I said, okay, Lord, but really what I'm about now is to make sure I get a meal on this flight. That is the important thing for now. But I got home and I shared it with my wife and then the journey began. 2 years later, I found myself in this country. Now, when I came to the country, when I was coming to the country, a few offers were made to me to plant the church that I left from at that time. And also the church that had invited me about 2 years before wanted me to plant, to do a mission work and to plant a church here in the West Midlands. But there was no clarity on that. And I thanked them very much for how much they trusted in me to be able to do that. But I carefully declined it because I knew that that was not the time. And I didn't have in mind to want to plant a church. That's the reality. I just wanted to serve God, as I've always done. And so I carried on like that. I joined ministries. I worked for one ministry for 9 years, working as if that was the last thing I would do. But I kept on running with that word. And I was sharing it year in, year out. Some of you have known me since the year 2002, 3, 4. And you can know that if you listen to some of my messages that I was privileged to preach then, I used to say how God spoke to me in 1998, that I would leave my home country and come out to do the word he has given. So, but I kept on protecting my vision. In the year 2003, I came out. I was just employed as a lecturer at the University of Wolverhampton after I finished my PhD studies. And I came out of my car in front of the Molyneux. As I stepped first foot to the ground and I was about to shut the door of the car, leaving to my office, I just heard a voice. He said, the people I am committing into your hands, treat them seriously. They matter to me. I said, Lord, which people? I'm going to work. He said, they matter to me. And since that day, I understood that there will be something about that vision 5 years earlier on that will have to do with people and making sure. That is why nobody that I deal with today and I relate with, I don't treat seriously. As much as God helps me, I'm not perfect. It's a journey for me. But if you come my way, there is no way I would just treat you anyhow. Because it is not about you. It is about the person who said to me, I should treat his people seriously, that they matter to him. And so this is how life is. And I kept on protecting that. And until November 2012, when God spoke to me and said to me that it was time for me to plant a church, to do a church plant. And he began to give me the vision as to what the church plant mandate would be. And so on and so forth. And a lot of us will now know how all that has culminated into the work we are doing now here in LifeGate. But after that church of 9 years work, I did another one for 4 years before God now asked me to carry on to do this. So we must understand that there is measurable impact, and it's not just a sense of grandeur. As time passes by, it becomes real and tangible, and the manifestation of what God has said begins to come to pass. We quote a lot from the book of Habakkuk, of the prophet Habakkuk, who had a revelation about vision and what God told him to say and to do about the vision. But if you read from Habakkuk chapter 1, Habakkuk was a prophet that was asking a lot of questions. He saw a lot of injustice in his time. He saw people who did not fear God and regard God triumphing. And he said, why are you letting all this thing happen? And do you know that those questions still exist today? They still exist in the day and age that we are. You see people who have utter disregard for God, and people who would not want to hear anything about God, seemingly doing well, being successful. And many times in your subconscious, you might ask God, you say, but Lord, we are the ones who are serving you. We are the ones who call on your name day and night. Why is it that these people who have a disregard for you are the ones that seem to be favored? And like Habakkuk, we have the right to answer those questions. But we must understand, like God said to Habakkuk, that there is something about his divine way of doing things that we must embrace. When David asked such questions, he said, it was when I got to the temple that I understood their end. When I got to the temple, I understood that there is a place of success, and there is a place, this is my paraphrase now, of success, and there is another place of good success. What the children of God should always aim for is good success, whereby you are succeeding by the power of God and the enablement of God, not by the trickery and the dubious and devious measures of man. And so what God said to Habakkuk starts in verse 5 of chapter 1. The Lord replied to him. He said, look among the nations and watch, and be utterly astounded, for I will work a work in your days. Somebody say, a work in our days. He said, for I will work a work in your days which you would not believe though it were told you. Hallelujah. So the prophet began to yield, but at the end he asked another set of questions. And God was now telling him that he was going to use the Chaldeans, who were people who were not God-fearing, a people who liked to just, do things the way they are. He said that their horses were like leopards. He said that those people had different kinds of attitude, that one of the things they do is that they believe that they are their own God, and they reserve judgment to themselves. And he said, these are the people that would take over things. And Habakkuk kept on asking, why do you like to use people who are so bad and so perverted to keep oppressing? And what God was letting him see is that his own people were drawn away from him, and his desire is for their hearts to be drawn back to him. Praise the Lord. The church must understand that until our hearts are right and our hearts are in the place where God wants us to be, we keep giving evil the opportunity to triumph. But the Bible says we should not be overcome by evil, but we should overcome evil with what? With good. Romans 12:21. We must always understand this, that we have a responsibility to rise up and not allow evil to continue to permeate in the land. And this was what God was saying. And so God began to say that the just shall live by his faith when he spoke to Habakkuk. Now when Habakkuk decided to stand upon the watch in Habakkuk chapter 2, when he decided to comprehend what God wanted to do in understanding why God was doing all this, he said in verse 1 of chapter 2, let's read it together. I will stand my watch and set myself on the rampart and watch to see what he will say to me and what I will answer when I am corrected. Verse 2. Then the Lord answered me and said, write the vision and make it plain upon tablets, that he may run that read it, or who reads it. Verse 3 is very important. Let's read verse 3 together. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. Read it again. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. Read it one more time. For the vision is yet for an appointed time. But at the end it will speak, and it will not lie. Though it tarries, Wait for it, because it will surely come. It will not tarry. The word of God will surely come to pass in your life. I said it will surely come to your pass in your life in the name of Jesus. You must be assured, like God assured the prophet, that everything will happen only in the process of time. And after that point, he now said that even though the wicked ones are doing what they are doing, he said the just shall live by his faith. That's what he said in verse 4. The just shall live by his faith. And so Habakkuk now began to understand, okay, this is what is happening. And so we must not be discouraged when we see the evil around us and we see people prospering, doing things that are seemingly ungodly and yet getting away with it. A lot of people getting things done in the very odd ways, in the very unconventional ways, in the very ways that the Bible simply condemns. We must not be moved by those things and feel discouraged that God is not mindful of everything that concerns us. What God is saying is that we must have faith to believe that his word, that is yea and amen, is able to save, is able to set free, is able to do what he has said he will do. It is just needing a process of time. So when Habakkuk understood this, he now said in Habakkuk chapter 3, from verse 17, he now said, okay, now I understand this, and this must be our stand as well. Let's read it together. He said, though the fig tree may what? Blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flock may be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls. Verse 18. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God, verse 19, is my strength. Tell your neighbor for me, the Lord God is your strength. Say, the Lord God is your strength. Keep rejoicing in the Lord. Keep rejoicing in the God of your salvation. He said, the Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like the deer's feet. Strong, energetic, powerful, running. And he will make me walk on my what? High heels. Hallelujah. This is so important for us to embrace. That whatever we see around us, even though the fig tree may not be blossoming, even though it may look as if there is darkness on the land, the Bible says we should arise and shine, because our light has come and the glory of the Lord is risen upon us. What that means is that we must believe the word of God constantly, conscientiously, and continue to protect the vision that God has given to us. A lot of us have thrown away our vision because the fig tree was not blossoming. A lot of us have not allowed our visions to thrive because the things that should seemingly have fallen in place have not fallen in place. I took time earlier at the beginning of this message to tell you my journey in getting to this humble position by the grace of God, so that you can understand that when God speaks something, it doesn't have to happen in the next instant. As a matter of fact, when God speaks something, most of the time, it takes some time to happen. But he begins to show you line upon line, precept upon precept, how it's going to be. And may the Lord continue to help you to be strengthened as you protect your vision in the name of Jesus. There are three levels. Somebody say three levels. There are three levels of vision that we must always seek to protect. The first level has to do with our personal vision, our personal calling. Because every one of us is called to do something. Everyone. You have a purpose. God created you and I for a purpose. As you have heard many times, nobody just happened by reason of a biological accident. God made you so that you can fulfill a definite purpose in life, and he made you so that you can impact your world in your own way. Now, not everybody, like I said, will impact the world globally, in quote, but everyone has the potential to impact the world globally as they walk their vision alongside others. Do I make sense? Praise the Lord. So we must learn that we must protect whatever personal thing God has called us to do. If God has called you to sing, you must protect that, develop that ability, because it is to bless the body of Christ and to be an inspiration to many. Praise the Lord. If God has called you to run business and be an employer, imagine people who God has called, even people who have no idea that it is God that has given them so much prowess to be huge entrepreneurs. Imagine if they didn't do what they did. If the Bill Gates of this world did not take time to step out and do the things they did in the world of information technology and in the computer world. If the likes of Mark Zuckerberg and Richard Branson and the big-time entrepreneurs that we know in our day and age don't step up to do the things they do, or the likes of Kenneth Copeland, the likes of the late Kenneth Hagin, the likes of David Oyedepo, and these people who are doing huge work all across the world. The men of God, like John MacArthur, who stands for the truth and the principles of the Word of God, who has stood for over 40 years preaching heavily on the message of sanctification, helping to keep the church in check for 40 years, helping us to point out where there is so much error and helping people to be corrected, because there is always the perversion of the work of the devil that keeps going on. People start off well and then they veer off. The likes of MacArthur will say that is the point, he missed it, without missing words. Not because he's taking upon himself to be a policeman, but because that's the calling. God will, in every generation, raise a prophet who will always be there to stand to say, like Jeremiah, you are preaching what God has not commanded you to do. Praise the Lord. It is a unique assignment. It's not meant for everybody. You stay to do what God has called you to do. Praise the Lord. If you go and point to somebody else, like John the Baptist was pointing to somebody else, you know what happened. Somebody say, God forbid. But you see, when you are staying in your calling, you understand that you have to protect your vision and let it deliver accordingly. We must protect our vision in the local church. Every one Christian is meant to function actively. Somebody say actively, as part of a local church. God has never called any one Christian to be an individual island. The Bible says, we all as living stones are fitted together to form a holy temple, a spiritual house, to offer up sacrifices unto the Lord. So we are called to a local assembly, and that local assembly, the local church, will always have a vision. Every church we have planted has a vision, and as we are protecting our individual visions in life and individual callings to be teachers, lawyers, doctors, engineers, educators, people who work in the arts, architects, and so on and so forth, as we are protecting those personal individual calls of ministry, the apostles, the prophets, the pastors, the evangelists, the teachers, everything working together, we must bring them into the local church God has called us and where we are planted to allow the vision of that church to thrive. The reason why we teach the way we teach and preach the way we preach and share the way we share and do the things we do the way we do is because there is a vision. There is a mandate upon us to deliver in a certain way. And we must continue to protect that mandate, even as God has called others to protect the mandate that they have been called to protect. And may the Lord continue to help us in Jesus' name. And then we must protect the overall vision. I told you there are three. Your personal vision, your vision, the vision of the church you are planted, and also the overall vision of Jesus Christ in setting up the global church. The church he talked about, that he said he would build, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. The body of Christ in its entirety. We have one mandate, every one of us. I told you a couple of weeks back that that mandate is to go into all the world and preach the gospel and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. This is the vision of the church globally. This is what every church should be doing. But within that vision, within that mandate, every local church has a specific focus that will enable the work to be done. Hallelujah. If you work for a large global organization, you will understand this much better. The bigger your organization, the better you will understand the specializations and the components of how it all works. Some of us work for the NHS, and we know that the NHS is not just made up of doctors. It's not just made up of physios. It's not just made up of nurses. It's made up of so many other disciplines that come together and work to make that organization efficient in delivering what it's called to do. This is how churches must see each other. Some of us are doctors, in quote. Some of us are the architect kind ministries, in quote. Some of us are the evangelistic, always going out once. Some of us are the teaching ones, always teaching, building people solidly. Some of us are those who are called to walk in the prophetic, and so on and so forth. Now, the churches must take their mandate all in culminating together so that they can become effective in delivering the global vision. Praise the Lord. And so in all these things, we must learn that these levels of vision must always be protected. There are about five enemies of vision that I want to quickly talk about. These are the things that always threaten the ultimate fulfillment of whatever vision God has given you. The first thing is fear. Somebody say fear. Fear born out of prevailing circumstances. As you take steps to implement your vision, even while you are receiving directives from God, there will be the tendency to be afraid. The devil will always scare you with the things that you see around you. Hallelujah. And we must understand that there is no place for fear. For anyone to be able to accomplish anything in life, you have to overcome different levels of fear. Some of you, when you started out in life and you were looking at doing the things that God has called you to do and you are now going into school, how many people truly want to admit that you were afraid of some examinations? Anybody, any such person? Or am I the only one? Were you ever afraid of an exam? Any exam whatsoever? Whether primary school, secondary school? Everybody. And it will look as if at that point, that thing was going to ruin you. But do you know that it was the fear of it that you overcame that helped you to pass? As many that cannot overcome the fear of whatever it is, they will still be at that level. So you have no business at any time being afraid of anything. As long as God has told you to take steps, you need to take the right steps and you need to keep going. Praise the Lord. The things that the enemy brings our way and they tend to want to make us afraid and God allows is not so that we can be consumed. It is so that we can be proven and tested and gain capacity so that we can take the next levels of assignment. Every leader, every parent, everyone who is charged with the responsibility of taking leadership position must understand that things will challenge you. The storms of life will challenge you, will challenge your steps, will challenge your advancement. You must at every time make sure that you don't allow fear. God allowed those things to prove who he has made you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. It was an old Swedish proverb that said that every captain, that is a ship captain, is good when the storms and the waves are calm. That it is when there are great storms that you know a very good captain. You only know a good captain. Every captain is good when everything is okay. Every pastor is sane when everything is okay and the church is doing well and finances are smooth. Every pastor is good. It is when you see challenges that you know a great pastor. Every leader is sensible when everything works well. But when they say that the company is going down and they lost one contract and lost that contract and lost, and you still meet the man and he's still as calm as he was when the contracts were rolling in 3 months before, then you know a great leader. So God wants to show that you are great. Don't let him down. When the storms are billowing and it seems as if everything is going haywire, keep your calm, keep your pace with God. Because what he's trying to show the devil is that you will not be miffed because you trust in him. Praise the Lord. You and I must understand that this is the place of having a responsibility where we see God. And I like something that Joel Osteen said very recently. He said that the water is never a problem to ships. In fact, water is their friend, because without water they can't float, can they? He said the only problem is when the water gets into the ship. So as long as you make sure that you are not allowing the waters, the waves that are blowing and billowing all around you to get into you, you stay in a place whereby you keep protecting your movement on your ship. Praise God. So you and I must always understand that we have no reason to succumb to fear. And from today, God will continue to give you victory over fear. In the name of Jesus. The Bible says God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. Then we have the threat of compromise. The devil always wanting to bring in the elements of shortcut, make it happen quick. Because it looks as if those people that are your peers and your contemporaries seem to have gone further. And the devil will want to make you do it quick and cut it quick. You've got to resist it. You've got to resist it. Compromise is something that is sent by the devil to cut short destinies. Quick fixes. We've got to make sure that we don't allow the devil to gain an upper hand in making us compromise our vision. The Bible says Daniel proposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the king's meat. It was good. It was offered. It could have made it good for him to just have it. But he said what was lying ahead was bigger, so he would not defile himself. Joseph said, should I do this thing and sin against God? I wouldn't let that cut my destiny short. Compromise is always lurking at the door of a true visionaire. You must work as hard as you can and keep praying. You cannot overcome compromise in your strength. There are some things that will be so heavily looking right to do because you just seem as if you just do it, you'll get away with it. So why not? You've got to keep praying, Lord, at such times when my flesh will be weak and when I will be down and it will seem as if I would give up. Help me not to give up. Help me not to fail you. Hallelujah. The reason why many people fail and compromise is because we try to fight the enemy in our own strength. You cannot fight. He has been around before, 6,000 years before you were born. He's been around. He knows all the tricks that you have not even heard about. The way he will present certain things that will look ordinary and look, you know, like he came and said to Eve. It's the same old style. Has God said? Has God said? You say, come on, you can do this one. Everybody's doing it. Then they get away with it. You will not compromise. I say, we will not compromise. We will not compromise in the name of Jesus. We must be mindful of distractors or distraction. They are sent to make you go off your course, go off your tangent. Now, in this day and age, you don't need physical people around you. You yourself can bring distractors into your life. As you go on the internet and you read things from newspapers and you get from news media, you can start to distract yourself without even knowing it. Comparing yourself, some of you will be on social media and you are looking at Facebook of your primary school friends who have become governors in the states in the country that you came from. And you're asking yourself, what am I still doing working in this kind of place? See, this one is now a governor. See, this one is now a minister. See, that one is this, is that. Or this one is now a successful businessman. And you begin to allow those things to distract you from facing your own vision and your own life. We must not allow distractions. Nehemiah, well, he had distraction from Sambalat and Tobias and the likes, but he did not allow it. Praise the Lord. People will always try to distract you. Moses was going to be distracted at a point by Aaron and Miriam. He did not allow it. You must do everything you can to fight against distractions. And may God continue to give you victory over them in the name of Jesus. The same way the distractors can also be opposers. The fourth thing you must fight is opposers, opposition. They always want to threaten your movement. They always want to slow you down. They always want to tell you why something is impossible. Anyone that is around you that is always telling you something is impossible must not be your friend, except they are your spouse. There is nothing you can do about that. Praise God. But I pray your spouse will not be like that to you. I say, I pray your spouse will not be like that to you. And if you are here, you are married to somebody, your responsibility is to keep encouraging them in righteousness. My wife said something to a lady some time back. She said, you know something? You must stand and be the person that is always encouraging your husband about church and about the things of God. Never be the one who is always bringing the things that will make him discouraged about going to church. It is very important. It is a big thing. If you do that, your man will be a God-fearing person and then you will have peace. It's very simple. Very simple. But you must understand that if you don't let your life be one that is encouraging, not encouraging to do evil, but encouraging to do the right things. As your life is that way, then the people around you will be able to manifest their dreams and their visions in righteousness. But you will have people, there's nothing you can do about it. You will have people who will oppose you. Past success is the last thing. Past success is good, but it can immediately become an enemy as long as it keeps itself in your focus every time. Praise the Lord. If you want to go anywhere, keep celebrating the victories of the past. I celebrate things from as far as I can remember in my life, some over 35 years ago that I can still remember vividly. I celebrate them. But the moment you are letting those things become all that you are thinking about, and you are saying, oh, how good it was last week. How good it was last year. Oh, how good, how good, how good. And you wake up and, oh, how good, how good. It will obscure your vision as to how what God wants to do even in your future. You have to make up your mind to keep protecting your vision against past success. And may God continue to help us all. I say, may God continue to help us all.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. I want to quickly read from Proverbs chapter 4, from verse 23 to 27, and just pick out five things as I round this up that God said we must do in order to protect our vision. The first thing is we must keep our heart clean. Tell your neighbor for me, keep your heart clean. You see, there is no room for bitterness, envy, or the likes in the life of anyone who genuinely, sincerely wants to succeed in their vision. You have no room for that. Let's read verse 23 together. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. When your heart, the Bible says, out of it. So if there is bitterness in your heart, bitterness is what will be coming out. If there is envy in your heart, every time you want to think, to give thanks about the testimony of somebody else, envy is what will come out instead of thanksgiving coming out. The Bible says out of it are the issues of life. So you must always make sure that you protect your heart. You protect your heart. There is a scripture in Proverbs chapter 27 verse 19. It said, as the water in the face reflects face, so a man's heart reveals the man. A man's heart reveals you. So you must keep your heart. Your heart is your production factory. It is where God deposits the seed of the vision and where God also begins to let it grow and gain an expression to your world. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. So that's the first thing. Keep guarding your heart. Friends, the devil will keep doing everything he can to make you bitter. I want you to understand that. Nobody is free from the potential of becoming bitter. No human being. Nobody. As long as you are in this life and you have to deal with somebody else, there is always a potential to be bitter. And there is always a potential for you to make somebody else bitter. Like I said last week, or was it 2 weeks ago, when I was up in Ireland last week, God spoke to me. He said that the principle of life that you have to abide by is to make sure that you do not be the source of offense, and you are also not one who is easily offended. Don't allow yourself to be the source of offense. And don't allow yourself to be offended. Both things God does not like. God does not like people who create offense. The Bible says in this world, you shall have offense. But woe to them through whom they come. God does not like it. God also doesn't like people who are offended. He said when in time John the Baptist's time, he said to the people, he said, blessed is he and they who are not what? Offended in me. So we must keep our hearts away from things that will pervert our journey towards our vision in life. Amen. Amen. The second thing is in verse 24. Read it with me. Put away from you a deceitful mouth and put perverse lips far from you. Tell your neighbor for me, walk in the integrity of words. Let your yes be yes and your no be no. There is another onslaught of wickedness in the body of Christ today. The spirit of lies and falsehood is a spirit we have to keep dealing with every day. It comes in very many subtle forms. It makes people just want to sugarcoat things. Some of the things I've been saying to you now, if I have not been saying them for like 12, 15 years, it will look like made-up stories. They will look like made-up stories. But if you get the tapes, if you can get them, if you can get the tapes of those messages from 2002, 2003, you will find that they are the same words as I'm repeating them to you today, because it is such a freedom to speak the truth. When you speak the truth and your yes is yes and your no is no, you live a stress-free life. You don't need to argument and pad it up. You don't need to think about what you said 5 years ago. If those stories were not true then, I would have had to be looking for those CDs and say, what did I say then? Just to be sure that it will be consistent so that nobody will find it out. But because it's true, I sleep, I wake up, you pinch me, I say, oh, this is what happened. Very clear. Some of the dates I still remember exactly, verbatim. Like the one I told you when I came out of the car. I shared it with the church I was then in 2003. That God said to me just that week that the people I'm committing into your hands, treat them seriously, they matter to me. I know the exact spot he spoke to me in the front of the Molyneux on that day. So it can't be taken away from me. Let your words, let your yes be yes, your no be no. And this will help you to have a people and a following and people who believe you for who God has made you. The Bible says, put away from you a deceitful mouth. And perverse lips must not be found with you. Perverse lips are lips that speak guile. lips that curse, lips that speak falsehood, lips that enjoy speaking perverted things, illicit things, lips that just enjoy singing things that are not glorifying to God. Now, and I know that when it comes to songs, it's a warfare. Especially if you have really, really listened to some songs before in your life. You understand what I'm saying? Because one thing with songs is that they don't go anywhere. No matter how born again you are. No matter how born again you are, no matter how sanctified you are. If you listen to Bob Marley many, many years ago, and you listen to it and listen to it and listen to it, all the lyrics you stored in your mind, then they don't go anywhere. There's nothing you can do about it. All you can do is when they want to come up, you say, I kill you in Jesus' name. Don't feel bad. It is there. There's nothing you can do. But what you should be doing is to keep replenishing it with good songs, good godly songs. Listen to the right tapes, the right messages, and it will help you to have lips that will glorify God. Praise the Lord. The third thing is found in verse 25. I have to move quickly now because of time. Read it with me. Let your eyes look what? Straight ahead. And your eyelids look right before you. Tell your neighbor for me, be focused on your goal. Hebrews 12:2, the Bible says, looking unto Jesus. You hear this from me all the time. The author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him, he began to endure the cross, despise the shame, and so on and so forth. You and I must understand that what we keep ahead of us every time in our vision must never be lost. Never lose it. Keep your eyes focused. He said, let your eyes look straight ahead. Don't look to the left or look to the right. He said, let your eyelids look right before you. This is talking about spiritual eyesight. Something Mark Twain said that I like so much. Mark Twain, I like his writings. A 19th century, very powerful Christian man in America. He wrote so many books and so many things. And one of the things he said is that never trust your eyes when your imagination or your vision is blurry. When you cannot see anymore in your realm of visioning and imagination, in your realm of dreams and in your realm of seeing beyond the eyesight, he said, never trust your eyes, because your eyes can only see the physical. Praise God. It takes vision for me to be saying to us as a church and the glorious level we are now, that a time will come for us to be doing the things that I was saying earlier on. It takes vision. It takes an eyesight that is beyond seeing what can be seen today in the physical. As much as glorious that is, and as much as thankful we are. But there is something you must always see, and that thing must never let go. He said, look straight ahead. Keep looking straight ahead. Tell your neighbor, keep looking straight ahead. And then verse 26, let's read it together. It said, ponder the path of your feet and let all your ways be what? Established. Let all your ways be what? Established. Ponder the path of your feet and let all your ways be established. Hallelujah. This means walk in the right circles with the right people. You need the right people every time. Not everybody can be your close friends. Not everybody can be your close associates. You don't need to choose enemies, but you need to select carefully the people that you speak with and the people that you share your vision with. Psalm 1 verse 1, it says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. That is the blessing. When you refuse to stand in the way of sinners, you refuse to stand in the seat of mockers, this is the way of blessing. Proverbs 13:20, he said that anyone who walks with the wise will himself be wise. Look for people who will stimulate your intellectual thinking. People who will stimulate your spirituality. People who will challenge you that what is God speaking to you now, this week. Don't say, that brother is always too spiritual, always asking me what I read in the Bible. That's a good brother. That's a good brother. Not the one that will say, did you hear the latest X Factor? Every time it's X Factor, X Factor. I don't have anything against X Factor, but the truth is, if that is all the brother is sharing with you, you can get better friends. The ones that will say, you know, that dream, that vision you shared with me 2 months ago, what's the situation now? Have you taken any steps? Have you, the one that will keep you on edge in the good way, where you are always wishing to reach for the next level, Husbands and wives, stimulate each other that way. What did you read this week? Which book are you reading now? You know, I found this. Email it. In this day and age, you can do so many things, sharing and encouraging each other. Very quickly, ponder the path of your faith. Proverbs 27, verse 17. Please note these scriptures. Psalm 1, verse 1. Proverbs 13, 20. And Proverbs 27, verse 17. He said, as iron sharpens iron, so does one man lift up the countenance of his friend. Make sure that you have the right circles of friends around you. You need to work with the right people. You need to understand the place of mentorship. Our generation does not like people telling them what to do. And so people, everybody, because we have the Holy Spirit, everybody wants to do what they think they should do. But there is still a place of people inputting into your life. The final thing is found in verse 27. He said, do not turn to the right or what? To the left. Remove your foot from evil. Say with me, be disciplined and remain God-fearing. Be disciplined and remain God-fearing. Discipline means doing the right things at the right time. In the process of time, God will cause everything to work together for good. You have to understand, discipline takes a lot from you. It was Winston Churchill that said, courage is the ability to know when to get up and speak, and also the ability to know when to just sit down and let things go by. It is courage. That you are keeping quiet on something doesn't mean that you are foolish. You are only disciplined and meek to have the strength under control, that you are not reacting as the devil will want you to react. Those of you in business, there are times people will want to cheat you, and the flesh will say, pick up the phone now and give them a piece of your mind. Tell the devil that the piece of my mind is good. Amen. Don't get involved in getting into a tussle with anybody. I always tell my business associates and business partners all over the world that projects will come and go, but people are always here. So I don't believe in coming together to do business and fighting. There's no point. There's no point. So when there are issues, we deal with the issues, we keep relationship, and we let it go. Even if the relationship is a one-off, but there is no need to part with a fight. Praise the Lord. I don't leave churches with fight. Never. I've never left any church in my life with fighting anybody. If there was issue, I made sure it was settled. We drank coffee together, we hung out together, and we keep talking. And I move on if I need to move on. But I don't move out because of issue. Never. I want you to understand something. That there is something about your life that means that you have to be disciplined. Do not turn to the right or the left, the Bible says. Remove your foot from what? Evil. Discipline means doing the right things at the right time. I want to close with Proverbs 27, verse 23 to 27, very quickly. He said, be diligent to know the state of your flocks and attend to your herds. When many of us read this scripture, we think it's talking only to pastors to know the state of their flocks, which is true, or to know the state of their church members, which is true. But every one of us must understand, Psalm 16, I guess, talks about the Lord that maintains our lot. Psalm 16, verse 5, I believe. He said that you are the one that maintains my lot. Every one of us has a lot. Every one of us has things. We have issues. We have things in life that we have to be diligent to know where we are. Our giftings, our callings, our family, the things that God has given to us, our friends. Let us make sure that we are tendering everything, knowing the state of everything. The way I have found to relate with people in different ways is I look at you and understand your weaknesses. When I know your weaknesses, I no longer have expectations on those weaknesses. How many people understand what I'm saying? If I know that you are a pathetic liar, not in this place, in Jesus' name. If I know that you are a pathetic liar, anything you say to me, I will hold it and I will pray very well that it is just the truth this time. But I will not be offended if 3 days later I find that it was not true, because you have told me, you have showed me clearly. This is how you can relate with people. I'm not saying that it's good for people to be like that, but you save yourself a lot of stress when you know the weaknesses of people. There are some people you can't trust them with money. Everything, no problem. But the moment money comes in, you see a tiger. They are different. Because that is just an area of weakness. There are people you can't trust with the opposite sex. Forget it. Because anytime is that, forget. Anytime whatsoever, forget. Go. You must understand what people's weaknesses are. And as you understand it, it helps you to tend your flocks, to keep your vision, so that you don't keep getting into problem with people. Attend to your heart. Verse 24 is very important. He said, For riches are not forever, nor does a crown endure to all generations. Riches are not forever. What you see today, the strength you have today, is not always going to be there. The ability you have today is not going to be there in that way. The life is moving very quickly. The job you have today, thank God for it. But you know, in 5 years' time, there will be younger people who are fresher, who will be contesting the same position with you. You have to understand it. So you have to tend your flock in your vision. Look at where things are. Every day I look at myself in the mirror, I tell myself my age, because the mirror can be deceiving me. The mirror can be deceiving me and be telling me that, oh, you are still a young man, you are still very fresh, even as much as I know I'm still young, but I count my own age and I look at time and I say to myself, this is where I must be in 5 years' time. You speak to some lady, you say, get serious with life, you need to settle down now. He says, I'm still young, I'm just 21. I'm so young. And some of them were talking like that 20 years ago. They're 41 now. They're still young. They're still young. You have to take your life seriously now. Now. He said, riches are not forever, nor does a crown endure to all generations. I was almost going to add to that one that except you are the Queen of England. She has endured a few generations. And she has won a world record now. So, you know, thank God for her. But she can't live for all generations. In as much as we respect Her Majesty and thank God for her life. Verse 25. When the hay is removed. Now this is important. When the hay is removed and the tender grass shows itself and the herbs of the mountains are gathered in. Verse 26. This is where you must understand when it says that the vision will speak. When everything has been done and the life cycles have gone. Read verse 26 with me. He said, the lambs, the ones you have been tending, the hay you have been providing for the sheep. He said, the lambs will provide your clothing. Maybe you saw the clothing in the vision, but a time was there. All you were doing is tending the flock and just making sure that they are there to produce. He said, when the hay is removed at the due time, he said, the lambs will provide your clothing and the goats will give you the price of the field. Verse 27. He said, you shall have, verse 27, you shall have enough goat's milk for your food, for the food of your household, and for the nourishment of your maidservant. This is how your vision will speak in the fullness of time. I said, this is how your vision will speak in the fullness of time. In the name of Jesus. That thing you want to go and study, that thing you want to go into, that business you want to go into, it will speak in the fullness of time. That ministry you want to step into and to start doing, it will speak in the fullness of time. In the name of Jesus, we are not all going to be sat like this forever, God forbid. Many people here are caught out for huge exploits around the world. And I decree and declare that as you start to take the steps that will take you to those points in destiny, my God will protect your vision. My God will establish your vision. You will arrive at your destiny. In the name of Jesus, it is well with you, spirit, soul, and body. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Give the Lord a big hand. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Amen.